The development of vaccines and the implementation of immunization programs for children and adults have been credited with virtually wiping out some diseases and increasing average lifespans by about 30 years. Recently, rates of immunization have dropped as some people have chosen not to get their children immunized. Consequently, some diseases thought to have been eliminated have been reappearing. Hello, I'm Shannon Fitzpatrick, and on this episode of At Issue, we will discuss the topic of vaccines, vaccine safety, and the importance of lifelong immunization against communicable diseases. With me is Dr. Bonnie Sorensen, director of the Volusia County Health Department, and pediatrician Dr. Valerie Burns. Thanks for joining us, doctors.
Thank you. We appreciate it.
Here to talk about something so important, immunizations. Why are they so important, and especially in children?
Well, immunizations are critical. As you mentioned, many diseases which used to ravage our population, cause hospitalizations and deaths, are no longer around because of vaccination. So it's extremely important to be vaccinated.
Dr. Burns, I'm sure you have something to say about that as well.
Yeah, a misconception I see often in the office is because people don't have personal experience with some of these diseases, they think it's not an issue and it's not a problem. And most of these diseases are not extinct. Most of these diseases are still circulating in the population, either in people who can carry the organism without symptoms or who can fight off the infection without much problem. But most of the illnesses that are included in the vaccines are necessary for the age groups they're indicated for.
I know we have some pretty strong statistics, about 36,000 deaths nationwide each year from influenza. A lot of people talking about the flu shots and how important it is to get the flu shots.
Yes, flu shots are particularly important because they impact the elderly the most, but everyone should receive a flu shot if you're above age 6 months. And every year we need to repeat that because the virus changes every year, and in order to keep up with it, the vaccine changes every year, so it necessitates our having a booster every season.
Studies show that infants are actually just as susceptible to influenza as the elderly, something a lot of parents don't appreciate. They're, small babies are just as likely to wind up in the emergency room or be hospitalized as the elderly. Another thing that's not appreciated about the value of immunizing small children is that children are vectors. Anyone who's ever been in a daycare knows children are very generous with their spit, their saliva, their poop, and influenza spreads rapidly in these settings. These children bring the influenza home, and they infect people in their home. They infect grandma, grandpa, great uncle Louie, who maybe didn't get his flu shot yet, or maybe they can't get their flu shot yet. So immunizing children is, besides protecting themselves, is also a way to protect the elderly people that usually we think of when we think of influenza
vaccination. And talking to your doctors is so important, as you're here to give out good information. There's no dumb question for a parent to ask about immunizations.
Absolutely. Just to ask your physician which immunizations are needed and how to get them.
And speaking of parents, we have a parent we'd like to hear from right now that has a question, a parent with a baby.
I just had a baby. He's about 2 months old. I'm not working right now, and money is a really big issue. He needs to get his shots, but some people tell me he shouldn't get all of them. Which one should he get, and where do I go to get them? Oh, and will Medicare pay for it?
Those are some really good questions from that parent, and I'm sure a lot of parents have the same questions. How would you respond?
Yes, those are critical questions. When do I start immunizations? Actually, babies receive hepatitis B vaccine at birth during their hospitalization. After that, they're going to need vaccinations at age 2 months, 4 months, 6 months, and another set of booster vaccines around 12 to 18 months, and then again before entering school.
So quite a few shots. And also the coverage. Parents are concerned about the coverage they have out there for these immunizations.
Only the immunizations that are recommended now are covered by private insurance. Families that don't have private insurance are usually eligible for VFC vaccine. These are the immunizations that are in the schedule purchased by the federal government and distributed to the states. Anyone can get these immunizations who doesn't have insurance. They can get them for free at the health department, I believe. They can get them in private offices that have VFC vaccine for a nominal fee.
And for childhood immunization, what immunizations are required or recommended? I know there's a difference sometimes.
Yes, there are a number of vaccines recommended and required. The ones at age 2, 4, and 6 months are sort of the typical diseases that we've heard about. Polio is one, even though we don't see polio any longer. Pneumonia, influenza, tetanus, diphtheria, whooping cough, a number of infectious diseases. The immunizations begin at age 2 months. Another round of boosters occurs between 12 and 18 months, and then before entering school, we also add vaccines against chickenpox, against measles, mumps, rubella. So by the time a child enters school, they should be fairly well protected.
Great. And does everyone get their child immunized? We're now hearing in the news, especially, that some parents are opting out for different reasons.
Right. Every parent is encouraged to have their children vaccinated, not only to protect the children, but also to increase the levels of immunization in our community. The more folks who are immunized in our community, the less likely, if an infection comes into our community, the less likely that it can spread amongst community members. There are instances where children are not vaccinated. For example, if a child has a very serious medical condition, their physician can ask that they be exempted from those vaccines. Some people have religious or philosophical objections, and there are processes for parents to opt out of vaccinations for their children, even though, you know, we would always advise that every child be immunized.
Dr. Burns, what's your advice to parents when they come to you wondering if they should or should not get their children vaccinated?
I'm a firm believer in immunization, and I usually make that clear to my parents at the first visit. And I remind them that their immunizations are not required for them to attend school. They're strongly recommended. They need paperwork to present to the school if they decide not to immunize a child. But I support immunization in my office.
I think the big word maybe that comes up is safety, and many are asking, are vaccines safe? Are they safe for my children? Are they safe for me?
They are very safe. They've been tried and true for many decades. At one time, I mean, certainly after a vaccine, a lot of children, a lot of adults will have some minor side effects, such as pain at the site of injection, a little fever, a little lethargy. But those are minor side effects. Over a decade ago, there became an awareness or a fear that vaccines were associated with autism or some other illnesses. And the scientific community has really debunked the thought that autism is caused by the vaccine or the preservatives that are in the vaccine. The vaccines are extremely safe. There's no scientific evidence showing that vaccines cause autism.
And aren't there a much higher amount of people getting the shots than not getting them in our nation?
Absolutely. In children, we monitor what percent of children at age 2, at age 4, and 7th grade, we monitor on an annual basis what percent of children are immunized. And our goal is that 90% or better of children are immunized. And we're always pretty close to that.
We want to talk about a really great program out there, Florida Shots, the Florida Shots program. Tell us about that.
Yes, I'm sure Dr. Burns has quite a bit of experience with that as well. Florida Shots is a great asset. Florida Shots is a statewide registry of all children who have received immunizations. The beauty of it is it's web-based. Any physician in any county, anywhere in the state, can log in and see what your immunizations are, can print you off a card that shows what the immunizations are, that you've already had. In the past, we relied on parents to carry a little card around, and if they lost it, oftentimes, they'd end up having those vaccinations repeated because they couldn't get into daycare or into school without having those immunizations. So it's a wonderful system that's available to all private physicians, to managed care entities, to be able to document what immunizations children have had, and it'll be there for a lifetime.
A great program with a lot of good information that I'm sure you hope to get out to as many parents as possible in your practice as well.
Yes, Florida Shots makes it a lot easier. You know, things happen to immunization cards, and parents forget sometimes. Mm. And it's nice to know that all that information is being saved someplace where it can be easily accessed.
And we know that parents love the easy button. It's very difficult to raise children as a parent myself. So anything we can do when a child gets sick, it's one of the worst things that can happen. So if we can do anything to prevent that or educate parents and make it as simple and easy, you all are the experts that can help cure and help get us what we need to do to make our children better. But certainly helping them with easy programs or prevention out there is wonderful. And there's a big question, you know, a lot of times people move to a new area or they've changed doctors. Where do I go to get my shots and who should be giving the immunizations?
Most private physicians, especially pediatricians, are giving immunizations. The health department, of course, is always in the business of immunizations, as are our federally qualified health centers. But the first stop really is your own private physician, asking if they're providing them, which ones they provide, and how you can access them.
And a lot of shot clinics are offered out there. When do you know what's the right clinic for you to go to? What kind of coverage you have? That can be confusing for some.
I think that is confusing. As Dr. Burns mentioned, insurance companies now cover the cost of immunizations, but if a person is uninsured, then you know they're up a creek, so to speak, because these immunizations are very expensive. But the health departments, as well as many private physicians, carry vaccines for children, VFC vaccines, and they are paid for by the federal government. So other than a minor small amount of administrative charge, these vaccines are virtually free for kids who don't have are not covered by health insurance.
And are there any differences between how the county has coverage and then the rest of Central Florida and other agencies that are able to provide coverage?
In terms, no, it's standard statewide. Medicaid covers immunizations, private health insurance covers immunizations, and for those folks who are caught without insurance, the vaccine for children will provide those vaccines to those children for free.
How do you advise folks who may come in, though, that are underprivileged, may not have insurance, may not have a funding source, or the knowledge where to go? Certainly, we'd hate to see a child go without immunizations because of the cost.
We offer immunizations in my office, VFC vaccines, at a nominal fee. For families that can't or don't want to do that, we suggest they go to the health department, and we have their information, their contact information, so parents can make the trip and get their children up to date.
All right, thank you so much for all of that good information. Now we're gonna hear from a mother with a teenage daughter with some important questions.
I don't remember having the HPV shot when I was a kid, but now my daughter is supposed to have the shot. She's not sexually active, and I hear that boys are supposed to have the shot now too. What is HPV, and why is it so important that they be immunized against it?
Wow, a lot of important questions from that parent relating to adolescents.
Yes, HPV is an abbreviation for human papillomavirus. It's a relatively recent vaccine that was originally recommended for girls, and now, as the mom says, it's also recommended for boys. And the reason for this vaccine is to prevent cervical cancer in girls and genital warts, which is a sexually transmitted disease, both in girls and in boys. So it's being offered to girls at a young age, anywhere between 9 and 12 or 16 or even age 26. A lot of parents are concerned, why are you offering a vaccine to my child who isn't even sexually active? And the answer is, in order to prevent cervical cancer or prevent genital warts. The virus that causes the genital warts also causes cervical cancer. So the whole idea is to be able to give the vaccine before a child becomes sexually active, both girls and boys. So it's an important vaccine. There's a significant number of cervical cancer cases across the country and a significant number of deaths caused by cervical cancer. This is one of the only vaccines that prevents cancer. And you know, if you can prevent cancer, it's a great opportunity to do
it's
that.
It's a window of opportunity, correct? That if once it passes, you no longer have the
right.
The...
If you're sexually active, the HPV virus is so common that everybody gets exposed to it. So once a child becomes sexually active, they are going to be exposed to HPV, and they've already been infected by the HPV, and it's too late to give the vaccine. So the earlier, the better.
Dr. Burns, maybe you can give some advice to parents who this is a delicate topic to talk about with your kids. How do you bring that up? Should you bring them into the doctor's office and bring this up? Should you talk to your child about this? It might be confusing to a child, too, that's not sexually active to be coming in for this immunization, for this shot, there should be maybe a family discussion beforehand.
I support the HPV vaccine. Unfortunately, most children really don't check in with their parents before they have their first, they make their, what they call it, a sexual debut. And most parents will admit, if you ask them, did you talk to your parents before you, you know, did anything the first time? The answer is usually no. And as Dr. Sorensen said, these viruses are acquired very rapidly. Most children are exposed to them within the first 2 years of starting intimate relations. And by then, the vaccine will do them no good at all.
So really having a good line of communication with your children early on, when it's age appropriate, but you need to start this conversation then early on. Really? And have a good line of communication with your kids.
Yes, and obviously just being aware that the HPV vaccine is available, and the earlier it's given, the better for youngsters, hopefully will prompt parents to have that conversation with their physicians earlier. Adolescents generally are pretty healthy, and they generally avoid doctor's offices, and it's hard to capture them. So it's a challenge for those of us who are providing those vaccines to make sure that the parents are aware of it so that they can bring the kids in. Well, there's a couple other vaccines we also like to give the adolescents, the boosters for tetanus, diphtheria, pertussis, as well as meningococcus vaccine to prevent meningitis. And that's the age when we try to catch those kids.
I know HPV, back to that, linked to cervical cancer, but also you kind of touched on oral cancer as well. So two very serious cancers linked to this.
Yes, it's cervical cancer in women primarily, but it also can cause anal rectal cancer in boys. And the boys pass it to the girls and vice versa. The vaccines will protect against the genital warts as well as cervical cancer or other cancers of that area.
And are you finding in your practice, are kids aware of these cancers? Do you think they're educated enough?
No, I don't think so.
No.
You don't really see oral cancers in teenagers. You might see it maybe in the 20s and 30s. But interestingly, there was a study done in Sweden. They actually bank specimens of oral cancers. And someone said, well, you know, how many of these viruses are in our oral cancers that were identified and treated in the 30s? And they went back and they looked. And as you go through the decades, this was in Sweden, and I imagine it holds true for the rest of the world, the prevalence of HPV virus in those cancers has steadily increased to the point where now in Sweden, about, I think it's 95% of oral cancers are associated with human papillomavirus.
Wow, so it's out there and we need to educate everyone as much as possible.
Right, those who are young enough to take advantage of it.
Great. All right, and now we're going to hear from an adult who works around children with a few important questions.
As an elementary school teacher, I'm around children on a daily basis that may not have all their shots. Are there any immunizations that I may need?
Really important questions coming from those who work around children all the time.
Yes, we certainly are always concerned that adults are going to get infectious diseases from children because, as Dr. Burns mentioned, children are little incubators of illnesses. But the opposite can also be true, particularly with whooping cough or what's called pertussis. We've seen sort of a resurging of the number of cases of whooping cough or pertussis in our state as well as in other states. And the reason is because adults who had their shots as kids, their immunity is waning, is sort of going away, and they get whooping cough and turn around and can give it to the kids. And especially the very young kids who really don't tolerate whooping cough as well. So nowadays, all adults are being recommended to have an update on their what's called a Tdap vaccine. It includes tetanus, whooping cough, and diphtheria, because if they were immunized as children, that immunity may be waning off, and it's time to get a booster for that. Influenza also is one of those infectious diseases that children oftentimes give to adults, but vice versa, especially in the daycare setting. Any thoughts further about that?
TDAP is also indicated for new parents. That's one of the target groups for the CDC. Since pertussis is such a devastating illness in tiny babies under 6 months, really under 7 months, if a baby gets all his shots on time, by the time he gets to be 7 months, he'll have complete protection. But before then, they're susceptible. If you look at those tiny babies that get pertussis, about 40% get it from their mom, and about 10% get it from their dad. So we're hoping by immunizing new parents, dads shortly before the delivery and moms immediately after the delivery of their baby, we'll be able to cut the incidence of pertussis in tiny babies by at least 50%.
I know some adults may have the thinking that, well, I'm too old, it doesn't really matter anymore, but that's really not the case. And knowing your records, what you've had, what you may need to get, and keeping up with the times when we may have new shots, new flu shots on the market, that they should be immunized just as much as the children.
Absolutely, and there are new vaccines also for older adults. We have the shingles vaccine that is now approved to be given to anyone over the age of 50. Those are for the adults who had chickenpox as youngsters can develop shingles as they get older. So the shingles shot now is recommended at least by age 60. The pneumonia vaccine is now being recommended as folks reach age 60, along with obviously our annual influenza shot. So adults are part of the immunization target group.
And now let's hear from a couple with some questions about traveling.
So my husband is going to be retiring soon, and we're planning to travel to Europe and South America. And I was just wondering, are there certain types of shots that we need to have for this trip? Where would we get them? Would we get them from our family physician or a clinic? And also, if we were going to take my grandson with us, would he get the same types of shots? I'm just wondering how that all works.
Traveling. When you travel to another country, what types of shots should adults get? How can they get that information? And certainly you want to be prepared before you're getting ready to get on the plane.
Yes. Interestingly, most adults nowadays go on the internet and they're able to come in and tell us what they need. But it is somewhat complex, and it depends on what area of the country that you're going to. Many areas of the country require malaria prophylaxis. Some require hepatitis A vaccine. Some require yellow fever vaccine. And of course, measles is prevalent out there in the world, even though we don't see measles locally. And if you're a young adult who has not had your measles vaccine, then you really need to get your MMWR, or your MMR, measles, mumps, and rubella before you travel. So it's complex, really. You know, ask your physician and they can give you advice.
Most of them will have an updated list of where you're traveling and what shots you'll need.
It's on the internet. Some of the vaccines, such as yellow fever, are only given by the health department. So most of the vaccines can be given by the private physicians if they carry those vaccines, but oftentimes they just send people to the health department because we have the entire array of travel vaccines available.
One of those shots being rabies shots. I know that's something that people sometimes talk about. Is that something that people need to get?
Rabies shots are usually given in response to an exposure, not as often given to folks prophylactically. We give them obviously to veterinarians because they have a continual exposure. But if you're going to spend a significant amount of time in a country, especially in the rural kind of open area, most people are touring, they're with a tour bus, they're fairly protected and don't go through the process of being immunized against rabies, but rabies is quite common in the roaming dogs of other countries.
Whether you're staying home or you're traveling, you really need to be prepared and immunized, it sounds
like. Absolutely. Absolutely.
Dr. Burns, any other information that you recommend, whether for adults or children, in the traveling situation?
Well, first of all, for children, I would suggest be sure before you leave the country that your child has everything that's indicated in the United States, because it's certainly indicated outside of the United States. A subgroup of people that travel overseas are people who are returning to their homeland, the place where they grew up or the place where they were born. And these parents typically tend to underestimate the risk for infections and sometimes don't look into malaria prophylaxis before they travel overseas. So I would ask parents who are traveling back home in their excitement of being reunited with family and friends and seeing all the places that they knew when they were growing up, remember that their children have no experience with what never bothered them when they were growing up, and that any natural immunity they may have required when they were growing up has probably lapsed. So they should discuss their travel plans with their pediatrician and their own physicians before
Make
they go.
Make that part of your travel planning. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Thank you. Dr. Sorensen, Dr. Burns, we're about ready to wrap up. Any closing comments or anything we may not have covered?
Well, I think it's very important that for children as well as adolescents as well as adults to keep up with the recommended vaccines. not only protects each of us individually against some ravaging infectious diseases, but it also protects our community at large. The more of us who are protected, the more our community is protected.
Dr. Burns?
A lot of parents will do preliminary research online, which is wonderful. But I would like them to bear in mind that not everything they read on the internet is true. And if you just Google immunizations, most of what you're going to find are anti-immunization websites. So please, when they're looking online and finding information, read it critically.
Ton of information out there. You want to make sure you're getting the right information, good information, and certainly starting with your doctor is an excellent place to start when having any kind of questions about shots, immunizations, vaccines.
Exactly.
For more information, please visit www.cdc.gov or www.volusiahealth.com. I would like to thank Dr. Burns and Dr. Sorensen for joining us for the discussion today. I'm Shannon Fitzpatrick. Thank you for watching At Issue.